Okay, so here's my sorority tree.
I know, I saw that.
That's my sorority, 1908. And so we went, okay, so let me just tell you. On Friday, so you know the whole thing about dress down Friday?
Yeah.
No, at Howard, this is called the yard.
Uh-huh.
And we would dress up on Fridays.
Uh-huh.
And then just promenade, everybody would promenade, hang out on the grass. All the Greek organizations would step around their trees. So there's the Kappas.
Oh yeah, all of them are here. We're sitting here, you're giving me a tour, and it's empty.
I know, I thought about that, because school's supposed to start this week.
Yeah, and because they're not coming back, it's all virtual.
I was thinking the same thing, like, oh my God, that I would be coming back to do this interview here, and if all the students were here. But it's a very special place.
You have fond memories, obviously.
Oh, very fond.
How did this place shape you?
Oh, in profound ways. I mean, look, we were in Toni Morrison's, where she wrote, in that room that we were in. Thurgood walked this campus. I mean, it's just the long legacy. And it shaped so much of who I am. My first office that I ever ran for, first office, was freshman class representative of the Liberal Arts Student Councils.
And you won, of course.
I won.
Yeah. Uh-huh. And when you were running then, did you just think, oh, I want to be a leader on campus? Or did you have in the back of your mind, truly?
I never had it in my mind that I would run for public office. It was, it was an exciting time. Reagan was in office.
Mm-hmm.
We would go up to the mall and protest apartheid. And Howard has a long history and legacy of real student activism.
Well, so I have a quote here from your book, where you talk about Howard, the beauty of Howard. Every signal told students that we could be anything.
Yes.
That we were young, gifted, and Black, and we shouldn't let anything get in the way of our success.
That's true. It's true.
So what did that mean for you, particularly as a Black woman?
It meant that you could do anything, and you didn't have to be confined by anyone else's idea of what it means to be Black. You could be a fine arts student and also, be class president. You could be homecoming queen and be the head of the science club. You could be a member of a sorority and be in student government and, want to go to law school. And it encouraged you to be your full self.
What did AKA mean to you, and what did it do for you? And
it's
AKA
a sisterhood.
Being,
it's a sisterhood.
And it has 1908 on the tree there. That was when it was founded.
We're the oldest Black sorority. And this is true for all the Black sororities and fraternities. I mean, Kappa Alpha Psi, Delta Sigma Theta. I mean, you could go around Omega Psi Phi. All of these sororities and fraternities, known as the Divine Nine, were founded on a principle of scholarship and service. Mm-hmm. And so it was about what you do for the community, what you do with this education that you have that is about serving and giving back.
Your family.
Yeah.
So we're here on a college campus. We're not calling her stepdaughter. What do you call her?
My daughter.
Your daughter.
Ella.
Okay.
Uh-huh.
Your daughter Ella is in college. The fact that we're at an empty campus, you're dealing with that in your real life.
Yes, we are.
How college kids.
And she's a senior,
and
all
so what
of
is
her
she
classes
doing?
Are online, but she wanted to go back to school. So she's in her apartment with her roommates, and they're learning online and kind of trying to figure it out. Your heart breaks. You want your kids to be able to, especially at that phase of life, to explore and to not be cooped up in an apartment looking at a screen, right?
Mm-hmm.
And they certainly
don't
want to do that.
I think it's really fascinating that you are, I know you don't call yourself a stepmom, you call yourself, or they call you Mamala.
Uh-huh.
But still, you came into their lives at midstream.
Yeah.
At a really critical time.
Yeah, they were teenagers.
That must have been very hard.
You know what? I am a child.
I am a child of
divorced parents. I was five when my parents separated. One of the keys to my relationship with Cole and Ella is their mom.
You guys are good friends.
We are friends. We have a very modern family. I mean,
Kind of happened naturally?
It happened naturally. And the thing about blended families, if everyone approaches it in the way that there's plenty of love to share, then it works. Early in the beginning, I'd come home. I mean, it's still, but as soon as I get home, I put on my sweats and I go into the kitchen and I start cooking, right? And so at one point when we first got together, I said to Doug, I said, I don't think the kids know what I do.
Did they?
I don't know if they fully appreciate it, because literally I'd go into the kitchen, they'd come in, we would talk about school, their dating life, whatever. And because that's who I was at home.
Well, they certainly know now.
And now they do know.
And on that, I got to ask about your husband, Doug.
Yes.
He, if you win, will be the first second man.
I know.
How does he feel about that?
Doug is just, he has the best sense of humor. He's so incredibly supportive.
It takes a certain kind of man.
Yeah.
To feel comfortable in the shadow of a woman.
He and I, we don't think of it as shadow, right? Uh-huh. We are partners.
Well, in terms of the public eye. I get that.
We're also challenging, right? Each one of us, as we move forward, we're challenging notions of gender and who does what and what that looks like, right?
And he's obviously comfortable with that.
Yeah, he's so comfortable in his skin. Mm-hmm. Yeah. No, that matters.
What would your mom say about where you are right now?
I think she'd be really extremely proud. And she would say, beat Trump. My mother was a scientist. She had two goals in her life, to raise her two daughters and end breast cancer. She was one of the, all 5 feet of her, one of the strongest, most loving and toughest people you've ever met. And she raised us to live a life of service. And she would look at the suffering right now, she would look at the denial of science right now, and it would piss her off, excuse my language.
You think she would be surprised that her daughter was the first woman of color on a ticket?
I don't think she would. I think she would be immensely proud. But she always encouraged us to go for it. She encouraged me to never listen to no except if she said it, Yeah.